God has brought you to this place. There are so many places that you could have been, so many other ways that you could have spent this Sunday, but you chose to do it here with this people, with this gathering of saints. So I welcome you and I thank you for choosing to share this Sunday with us. Would you all please join me? And I call to worship. Peace be with you. We gather in this place to worship our God. We gather with fellow pilgrims as we seek to follow Jesus. We are brought together by the Spirit who lives in the depths of our souls. Join me in our gathering prayer. We give thanks to you, O God, for you are good, for your steadfast love endures forever. We have redeemed us from trouble and gathered us in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. When we cry to you in trouble, you bring us out of our distress. We thank you, God, for your steadfast love, for your wonderful works to mankind. We lift up your name here in the congregation of the people and pray you in the assembly of the elders. We worship you here today together. Amen. Please rise and join me in singing our hymn number 102, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Guide me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Would you all please join me now in our prayer of confession? You can be seated. God, you made us to be neighbors, members of one family, blessed with great diversity. You created us to be helpers and friends to one another, entrusting to us your justice and your joy. Yet we have too often not loved one another into wholeness. We have not often enough taken whatever we have to build worlds of justice and joy for all of your children and creation. We have not often enough been open to your works of wonder in the midst of those cast to the margins of our society. We have sometimes missed Jesus because of this. Still, you are with us and you hold us. We ask your forgiveness and pray to be transformed to better reflect your love and mercy in our world. Loving God, you restore us to each other and to you, mending our hearts and repairing the world. Through the power of your Spirit, you shape us to be for others what Christ is for us, pardon and peace, new life and blessing. We give you thanks for your love, forgiveness, and constant presence. Amen. Please join me in our hymn of response, number 375. We, number 375. Calming words with a peaceful spirit, with overflowing love and hope. Our God forgives us and fills us with faith.
Our God forgives us for who we are, those whose brokenness is made whole, whose sins forgiven, whose lives overflow with faith. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Verses 1 through 4, 7 through 9, and 12 through 20. Thank you. Then God spoke all these words, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether it be in the form of anything that is in heaven above or that is on earth beneath, that is in the water or under the earth. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but in the seventh day is Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work. You shall, your son and your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock or alien resident in your own towns. For in 6 days the Lord has made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in it, but rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother so that your days may be long in the land of the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female, slave or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. When all the people witnessed the thunder and the lightning, the sound of the trumpet, the mountain smoking, they were afraid and trembled and stood in the distance and said to Moses, "You speak to us, we will listen, but we do not let the God speak to us, or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, for God has come only to test you and to put the fear of him upon you so that you do not sin." Thank you for the reading of the word. Please join us for our next hymn. Hymn 403, "Lord, I Want to Be a Christian."
One of the great tragedies in my lifetime is that in the main, we as a society have forgotten that each new generation must learn what it is to be a civil society. We've proceeded as if it simply comes by osmosis, as if our children will learn what it is to be a civil society, what it is to be a society given not to the base instincts of our species, but to the better angels of our nature. Learn anew what it means to be a people summoned by something larger than ourselves to a destiny more than a replication of the past. We have allowed the notion of the common good upon which all human societies depend. We have allowed it to wither and be overgrown by a thicket of parochial and petty resentments of racial and ethnic animosities. I call this a tragedy because the consequence of this loss of imagination about the civitas is that the most vulnerable among us, those who are most vulnerable, our children, our old, and the poor, suffer unnecessary and needless hardship because of it. When the threads of a creative social vision of morality become visible because the cloth that ought to hold us together is thin, the least of these among us, our children face peril and uncertainty. Now, the tragedy of a morally threadbare society takes flesh at every corner on our city, at which someone must rely on a cardboard placard for their daily bread. It takes shape and is enfleshed when a child meets yet another day, when a full stomach is a dream reserved for someone else's children. I remember reading in the newspaper about how the children of New Haven, many children of New Haven and cities all over our country, were fearful that the summer had arrived. Now, I remember when I was young, I couldn't wait till the last day of school, because the summer was a wondrous time. But then again, I wasn't depending on school for my one full meal a day. That is a threadbare society when it comes to morality. Now, what lurks behind this is what I think is the greatest tragedy, which is our children grow up believing that this is normal. They grow up believing that it is normal that we ought to see poor people everywhere. They grow up believing that it is normal that we must see tents pitched in public parks because there are no programs to provide housing for our citizens. They believe it is normal that only some among them will know what it means to have a full meal each and every day. The sign of a morally threadbare society. Now, what put me in mind of this was our scripture for the morning. This story of Israel's encounter with God at Sinai is the bedrock of their identity, the place in which all who would come after place a pen on the great map of history. A pen to recall and remember, remember and recall themselves to those who had accepted that they were claimed by God and gave themselves fully to the covenant that came from accepting that claim. Now, when we think about this moment at Sinai, the focus, rightly, is on the dialogue, the Decalogue, or the Ten Commandments, which Moses brings to the people from God. Now, if you have a certain age, that image of Charlton Heston coming down from the mountain is something that is seared into your imagination because we saw it once a year, but we saw it every year. And that was the moment that was captured, the moment that was the signal point of Israel's accepting of God's claim. Now, I want to shift the focus a little bit this morning, and I want to turn the camera, if you will, on this film, to the audience, the people receiving these commandments, these rules for living as the people of Israel. I want to turn it to the people, turn it to the ones receiving the Decalogue, turn it to the ones who stand receiving God's word, the ones who at the end of our scripture lesson for this morning thanked Moses for this guidance but asked for his protection out of fear. Now recall Israel, the people who received this were people who had recently been led from slavery by the power of God. So they were no strangers to the power of God. By a mighty hand, God had delivered them from slavery. They had been the ones who had crossed the Red Sea and been guided by a pillar of fire by night and a column of dust by day. The people who still bore the marks of the taskmaster's whip. These were the people who but months before, had but weeks before, known only bondage. When we shift the focus to them, when we shift our focus to them, this moment at Sinai becomes something a little bit different than just simply receiving some rules, simply receiving a word from God. When we take stock of who received these words, these commandments from God, this whole image, this moment, takes on a slightly different character. At least one dimension is that God is giving to a group of former slaves. Repeat after me, a group of former slaves. These were the ones who God was revealing God's will to, God's guidelines, is that God is giving to a group of former slaves guidelines for building a civil society. God was giving them an outline for how they ought to live with one another. Now, in today's political climate of wanting to rewrite history and erase the history, particularly the history of those who were descendants of former slaves, this bears repeating, that God was speaking to these former slaves and those who would be their descendants, speaking to them of how life ought to be among them. A life very different than they had known when they were in bondage. Recall that the time of their enslavement to Pharaoh, since the Pharaoh arose that knew not Joseph, was actually hundreds of years. So the time between when they descended into Egypt and were taken into bondage and when Moses appears is a few hundred years. So what that means is that there was no one among them who had known freedom or knew anyone who had known freedom. The only free people that they had known about had been people who lived in myth and legend. Now here's why that's important. Human history and our history here in America has given us an unequivocal picture of what worlds created by slavery look like. They are worlds that are built upon cruelty and craven covetousness. Entire universes in which cruelty is the point. Entire worlds in which using other human beings to feed the need and the desire of covetousness was ubiquitous. Now, in such societies, notions of human worth and dignity are laughable at best. So when God gives these commandments to the people of Israel, it is a framework for a different kind of society than the one from which they had come. A different polis, if you will, a different world, a better arrangement of human relationships. The two hallmarks of the world that God envisions and gifts as a vision to them is a world in which regard for your neighbor and a devotion to a creation of a self rooted in something more than cruelty and covetousness. These were the two poles, regard for the neighbor and enough regard for yourself that you would be better than the world from which you came, that you would be better than simply living in a world that's all about covetousness, that's all about using other human beings to get whatever you want. These were the two hallmarks. The imprimatur, if you will, of which is their dedication to God. Now, let me be clear, so I will say it slow and I'll say it loud. Our text for the morning, the Ten Commandments, are God's vision of a civil society. God's vision of a civil society based on regard for your neighbor, first, and creating a self based on that regard, all done in service to your devotion to God. So this is how you show God that you have accepted God's claim, is that you build a life of regard for your neighbor and build a life in which yourself, your very understanding of yourself, is rooted in that regard. Or as Jesus would paraphrase several thousand years later, you shall love your God with all the strength of your heart and your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. A paraphrase which he said was the sum of all the commandments. Now it is important to step back from the individual commandments to see this broader vision. Because, you know, we also live in a time and in a place where people only want you to read a text over here, a text over there, a text over here, and they don't want you to see the big picture. But I'm inviting you now to see the larger picture of what's going on with the Ten Commandments, particularly because it is important in times like ours, times in which, for so many, the cruelty is the point. Times in which covetousness becomes the rule, leaving human dignity a casualty on the side of the road. It is important for us to remember that God does have a moral vision for our world and calls us to live it with all of our hearts and all of our souls, and allow it to be a compass and a guide for how we ought to live our lives. Now, this doesn't mean that we try to make a Christian nation. There are so many ways and so many spaces and so many times in which God has spoken to our sisters and brothers of different faith and of no faith, because our God is bigger than the demarcations of this religion, that religion. But it is incumbent upon us who hear God calling our names in the voice of Jesus Christ and who respond by saying we are Christians. It is incumbent upon us to live into that moral vision, to live into a moral vision that for whatever else it means to be a member of this society, having regard for our neighbor is at the center, and trying to make this a place that we can become better people in making a better world for our neighbor and for our children is at the center of our identity. So whatever else it means, however you decide to vote, whatever party you decide to join or no party at all, whatever it is that you decide to live out as your sense of what it means to be a citizen, a resident, an immigrant, at the center is a regard for your neighbor and their welfare and your commitment to creating a self that contributes to this world. We must, in our society, find ways that give witness to God's desire for our neighbors and for ourselves to be well cared for and to know wholeness and joy. As I close, I will simply give you my paraphrase of what the Ten Commandments call us to do and what is the social vision of what our society ought to be and that we need to be a part of. The kingdom of God is a world of full stomachs and smiling faces. Amen. We come to the time in our service where we have perhaps what is one of the great joys and one of the great privileges of being children of a God who loves us so, that we do not have to carry the burdens of life, nor hide the joys of life, because we can share them with one another, because we can hold one another up, and we can carry one another through all of the hills and dales, valleys and streams, mountaintops and hilltops of life. I invite you now to join me in prayer as we as a church go to God seeking wholeness and fullness. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. We join our voices to pray and rejoice for those celebrating birthdays, including Susan Paris Ray. We pray also for our planet, that it might know healing and peace, for all those suffering loss because of the ravages of climate change, for immigrants and refugees seeking sanctuary and safe harbor, for our nation, that we might not lose regard for human dignity and worth. For our children, that they may know hope and safety. For those that incubate our future. For those suffering the plague of gun violence. For those who suffer with mental illness. For those who endure physical and emotional suffering, for those suffering grief and loss of a loved one, for ourselves, that we may ever live in the power of hope. And I would add to this, we pray for those who find themselves trapped once again in the cycle of bloodshed between Israel and Gaza, particularly for Sam Bahour and Mahmoud Mustaf. I invite now your prayers that we might join together with you.
Prayers of hope, but mostly courage for my friend Fred, who is in hospice care at home now, and his family, and all of their close friends, and healing for my neighbor, Iris, and for all of those who, my Uncle Dan, who just underwent a procedure, for all of those who I haven't named, whose names I forget or don't know. Oh God, hear our prayer.
Mm-hmm. Prayers of strength and healing for all those dealing with cancer, especially Audrey as she undergoes chemotherapy. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Prayers for my friend Chris, who suffers from brain cancer and breast cancer, that the chemo wouldn't make her so sick. Prayers for my friend, my girlfriend, Lacey, whose uncle just passed away suddenly. Prayers of Thanksgiving for my brother Barnaby getting his job at Walmart. God, in your mercy.
A continuing prayer for the community love and will to address the crisis and causes of urban violence plaguing our cities. God, in your mercy.
A prayer for guidance for Jenica. God, in your mercy.
From online, from Deep White, prayers as I recover from my latest bout with COVID. God in your mercy.
Your prayer.
From David Garner, who needs prayers for his cat, Sparky. God in your mercy.
Your prayer.
And from Ruth Ann Olson, prayers for healing for her granddaughter, Anna, who is recovering at home after a hospital stay. God in your mercy.
Your prayer.
Prayers of healing for Mrs. Ruth Weich and for Ms. Judy Ann Jones.
God in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Continuing prayers for my brother Peter, who is doing better, and that's all that we can ask for. God in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Prayers of thanksgiving for the presence of Ron and Freddie here this morning, and prayers of safe travels and good health to them as they begin their journey a vita in Puerto Rico. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And we give thanks. Friends, please join me in prayer. Merciful and loving God, we are ever thankful that you continue to give us a spirit of comfort, that you give encouragement to our hearts. We ask that you would be present to those who have been named, who are suffering illness, who are coming to the close of lives that were well lived. God, we ask that you would continue to give them and their families, their friends, and their community strength and hope. For those who are healing, we ask that you would, as the old folk used to say, remind us that Jesus is still in the healing business, and that you would allow people to be made whole, that you would allow all of those to be made once again filled with health and filled with hope. We pray also, God, for people who find themselves in the midst of war zones, who find themselves trapped and can't escape. We ask that you would protect them, that you would protect them and that you would watch over them. And that for those lives that are lost, God, we ask that you would give comfort, and that you would give healing, and that you would give reassurance. And finally, God, we ask that you would allow each and every one of us gathered in this place to be a witness to your love and to your mercy and to the vision that you have for this world. All of this we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Amen. Announcements.
How about passing the peace?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sorry. Please. I'm sorry. Pass the peace to one another. And then we'll come back to the announcements. Thank you.
Good morning. Chris Morsky representing Faith Formation, specifically Oasis. There is no activity tonight, I think because of the long weekend. However, on Wednesday from 7 to 7:30, there will be an opportunity to gather on Zoom for Worship Wednesday with a focus of individuality.
Good morning. Jeff Hopper with Service and Justice. Just a reminder to everyone that the New Haven Pride Block Party will be October 21st, that's Saturday, between noon and 6 p.m. So hopefully there is a sign up in the Narthex, and hopefully folks will come and join us before or after the dramatic reading that's going to be held here. And next week we will begin collecting winter clothing for IRIS and Christian Community Action. So we will put a bin in the Narthex, and we are looking for new gloves, hats, and scarves in all sizes, and gently used coats or boots are also welcome. So that'll be a bin in the Narthex next week. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Roger Adams, and contrary to what it says in the bulletin, the Bible study is at 5:30 on October 12th. We're resuming the weekly meeting, and it will be on Zoom. Zoom information is in the e-blast, and just remember, it's at 5:30, not 4 o'clock. Also, as you know, we have a celebration coming up, but we can still use lots of help getting the word out to more people. In the Narthex, there's a box with a lot of these cards, and I would invite you to take several and pass them to your friends, post them on community bulletin boards, and in general, do things with it that would bring our celebration and the events coming up to the notice of a wide range of people. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Al Farino, your moderator here at United Church on the Green. I want to extend a great welcome to friend and family and member who are here this morning, whether you're here in person or watching us via the live stream. We thank you for joining us this morning, and we would like to invite you, whether you're here virtually on live stream, switch over to Zoom, to the Zoom coffee hour, or if you're here, please, after the service, as you leave the meeting house, to your left, go downstairs to the Bradley room, to your right, you can take the lift if you need a lift, and join us for coffee in the Bradley room. We have a great cornucopia of fall treats that Dale has prepared for us today. And you'll find a time of cookies, coffee, and conversation in a way to get to know each other a little bit better as part of our church family. Here at United, we want you to know that whether you are gay or straight or cis or trans or bi or anything in between, you are invited, welcome, accepted, and cherished here. We've been an open and affirming congregation since 1989, and we're very proud of that. So I hope to see you afterwards in the coffee hour. Thank you.
So the only announcement that I have, which is actually a very big deal, is that you all are here. So we give thanks once again for that. We come to the time in our service now where we are able to participate in the support of the ministry to which God has called this church, the offering. We invite that you give as you are able, knowing that anything which you give is more than enough, because God takes whatever is given and multiplies it. So if you give largely, if you give smallly, if you give of your heart, God will multiply that. I invite the ushers to come forward.
please join me in our prayer of dedication. God, thank you, thank you, thank you for your grace, for this community of faith, for the gifts of our lives. Bless these offerings today that they might be used to further your reign of righteousness here and now. Work through each of us and through the ministries of this congregation that we might glorify you in all we do. Amen.
Please join me now in singing our closing hymn, This Little Light of Mine, hymn number 364, This Little Light of Mine.
Thank you.
Oh, y'all can go, but I know you wanted to hear Caesar play some more, as I always do. So thank you. Blessings to each of you. Go now in peace. Oh, I forgot. Our worship has ended.